We'll move straight on without more ado to number two, which comes from Germany and the UK. And the title of this project is Achieving Food Sovereignty with Edible Insects, Breaking the Cycle of Poverty and Malnutrition. Your presenter for this project entry is going to be Darja Dobermann. And to introduce her, we have another of our BCFN alumna, Monica Pianosi. So Darja and Monica, come on out. Welcome. They can't shake hands, they've got too many things to carry. Leave you to it, guys.
Hello, everyone. Imagine you're living in a country where arable land is very limited. Imagine living in a place where children malnutrition is the norm. Imagine living in a city that is threatened by droughts and climate change. Unfortunately, this is the world we're actually living in. So how would you address the issues of food scarcity and environmental degradation? These are topics that are really important for the BCFN Foundation and for the alumni group. Darja and Charlotte's project address these topics from a very different perspective and in an innovative way. And we strongly believe that the strength and the success of their intervention lies in their approach, because they're not trying to change the food system, but they're working within the traditional food system. So I'll now leave the stage to Darja, who will present you the project.
As children, we're all told tales of ferocious dragons and knights in shining armor who defeat them. Now, while modern-day dragons may be more fiction than fact, they're just as deadly as those of tales past. Today, my partner Charlotte and I will present a project utilizing our complementary skills to take on one of the most pervasive dragons of our time, micronutrient deficiency, or hidden hunger. A lack of micronutrients in the diet impairs physical growth and inhibits cognitive development, creating an intergenerational cycle that's difficult to break. This tale plays out across the globe, but few regions are as severely affected as Western Africa. In the past, there have been knights who have attempted to take on this tenacious dragon with direct supplementation and food fortification. And these approaches do show positive impacts. But why are these impacts not reflected in the statistics? Why does the dragon inevitably defeat these earnest knights? First, money. A lot of interventions are designed with dependence on some form of economic subsidy, ultimately leading to their failure. Second, limited long-term compliance. Novel, unfamiliar products have little staying power when they're manufactured and supplied by strangers. We are proposing a new approach that works with the community and gives them autonomy over their food. More importantly, we found the best knight for the job. Our knight ranges far across Africa, seen in green on the map. Our knight is edible and much beloved by the community. Meet our knight, the Shea caterpillar. When not battle ready, this is how you'll find our knight. Now, what may be lacking in shining armor and fiery steeds is made up for with a protein, iron, and zinc content that's on par with chicken, and a strong cultural acceptance as a food source. But our knight faces a hurdle in her battle against the hidden hunger dragon. Availability. She's only available for a few weeks out of the year. The rest of the time, she's underground in a state of suspended development, known as diapause. This is our project, our saga to fight the dragon. We will work in Burkina Faso, the heart of our knight's range, and a country where we have spent the last 6 months building strong community and stakeholder support. We have already broken the diapause. Now, with funding from this grant, we will create an artificial feed and a caterpillar breeding protocol. Much like with the domestic silkworm, we'll develop a feed based on the caterpillar's main food source, the shea tree, and utilizing local biowaste from cassava and sugarcane productions. We'll trial this feed with rural smallholder farmers who have expressed a keen interest in caterpillar breeding. The majority of these are women. Leading on from this, we'll process the caterpillars into a flour that's suitable for children. We'll give this to mothers and monitor their children's nutritional status over a six-month period. We've spoken to mothers in Burkina about this idea, and they like it. They enjoy eating the caterpillars themselves, and they're keen to know if it would be good food for their growing babies. To help us on our saga, we will be working with several good fairies. Researchers Athanase Badolo, Antoine Sanan, and Ferdinand Battiano of the University of Ouagadougou, as well as Kahit Heen, the founder of FasoPro, will help us in developing the caterpillar breeding protocol. Germaine Minwagu, a member of the National Ethical Committee, Bertine Dabrier, the National Director of Nutrition, and Jacquie Simpour, a nutritionist, will provide support in monitoring the impact of the caterpillar on child nutrition. More importantly, we have the support of the community. They are ready and waiting. Once we pilot this project in Burkina, we can replicate it in the 18 other African countries that enjoy eating the caterpillar as a food. It is often said that the first 1,000 days of someone's life are the most pivotal. In the words of Roger Thoreau, it is in the 1,000 days that everyone is equal and the world's inequalities begin. With BCFN's support, we can take one step closer to ensuring that everyone starts and stays equal. We are battle ready. Will you be our fairy godmother? Thank you.
Darja, thanks very much indeed. Monica, experience shows we have about two questions in 4 minutes, so I'll leave you to steer us through that. I'm sure our panelists have some questions. Thank you so much.
Any question?
Yeah. How are you going to preserve the caterpillar to distribute to the population?
So that's where our partnership with FasoPro actually comes in. So they're a company in Burkina Faso that have already developed a hygienic way to store the caterpillars. Generally, they're stored whole and dried, and it's been shown through some microbial analyses that that's the best and safest way to store them. And it's estimated at this point that they have probably about a shelf life of a year at that point.
Are they acceptable to the population? In this form, they like it.
They absolutely love them. And so my partner Charlotte can actually contribute to this a bit because she has lived there for the past 6 months. So she can, if
right.
It's working, yeah. I'll let her.
Microphone to Charlotte.
Yeah. I'd just like to contribute to that answer. I've been living in Burkina Faso since May, and I can completely guarantee that the populations who I've been spending time with, doing field work with, really like these caterpillars. That's why we included that video in the presentation, showing the kids laughing and being really happy to have them, because caterpillar season is so short. It's 2 weeks, but it's like holiday season. Everybody's incredibly happy to eat them. And they say it's like eating meat every day. So.
Yes, how do you go from caterpillar to flour? Is it a freeze-dry procedure? Did you figure out also how much?
Well, freeze-drying wouldn't be a practical solution, unfortunately, in a rural environment. So right now, the way that caterpillars are preserved in the community is they're dried. They're sun-dried. Very simple. You lay them out, sometimes on roofs, sometimes on the ground, and they dry within a couple days, depending on the sun.
So you could combine it with the first presentation.
And then I think Charlotte can. So and then it's very simple grinding process with other seeds. So.
Could I just add to that FasoPro also have solar dryers at one of the sites that we've been working at, and they've been trialing using the solar dryers to dry the caterpillars, and yes, it does seem to have very good results. So.
I think we have time for one more question, if you have.
Thank you. Are there any other possible outcomes of changing this system of the caterpillar's lifespan? Have you looked into whether there's other externalities that would happen by changing this sort of natural system that already exists?
I mean, from what we can gather, not necessarily. If anything, it would have a positive impact on the system, because in some other cultures that have also relied on edible insects, you come into issues of over-harvesting. People don't harvest them in a sustainable manner, and then the over-harvesting will damage the wild population. At this stage, that's not the case, But because demand for them is so high and they have a high market value, it's very plausible that that could happen. So actually providing people the alternative to breed them in a sustainable way would take pressure off of the wild system and preserve the wild populations.
Just a quick one. Besides the micronutrient analysis of iron, did you look at any other components, like analysis of the composition of the caterpillars?
Yes.
If they have any toxic material presence.
We ourselves, as well as a few published reports, have done a full nutritional profile. So we know that they're roughly about 60% protein. And we've done iron and zinc. So iron's about 16 milligrams per 100 grams. And then we've looked, of course, at other potentially harmful things. So heavy metals is often a concern. And we did not flag up any of that. And a lot of that is also comes down to that they're processed very carefully to avoid contamination.
Right. Alas, our time is against us, but Darja and Monica, thank you both very much indeed for that presentation. Thank you.